All right, squeeze theorem. Squeeze theorem for sequences. If the limit as n approaches infinity of a sub n of sequence a sub n, or well, we're looking at the nth term of the sequence, is equal to L, and the limit as n approaches infinity of b sub n, so these are coming obviously from with the different letters, the different names, two different sequences, two different nth terms. If those are both equal to L and there exists the same real limit, an integer n such that, or capital N, a sub n is less than or equal to c sub n, which is less than or equal to b sub n for all n. Now we're talking about the lowercase n. Now we're talking about those positive integers, which is the domain of our sequence. For all n greater than capital N, then the limit as n approaches infinity of c sub n is equal to L. Remember that squeeze theorem. It's like, well, we'll see it with this example. Show that the sequence with the given nth term, forgot that phrasing when I wrote the notes up, so I'm just going to stretch it over there. A sub n is equal to 2 raised to the n power over n factorial. Show that that sequence with the given nth term converges and find its limit. Okay, well, with the examples that we just got done finishing, you know, we took the limit of the function and got a value, and if it was a real limit, we said the sequence converged to that real value, that limit. And I wanted to do some harder examples, so I gave some that required L'Hopital's or some manipulation to allow us to evaluate the limit. But, you know, we're going to have infinity over infinity, but L'Hopital is about taking the derivative of the numerator and denominator and allowing us to get into another form that allow us to evaluate the limit. But the derivatives of factorials, yeah, I'm not too sure about that. So what we did here is I made a t-table allowing n go from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 on all the way up to 6, and we see that the nth term of our sequence starts off of being 2, 2, and then it reduces to 8, 6, and 16 over 24 and so on, and it seems like the values are getting smaller, the values of a sub n are getting smaller as n increases. Okay, now because we can't necessarily really easily evaluate the limit of that expression, maybe we kind of know what the answer is intuitively, but if we had to prove you know, that the answer that we think it is, that, you know, the limit that we believe it is, if we had to prove it, how are we going to do that? Well, 2 to the any positive, positive 2 to any power is going to be positive, and these factorials will always become positive. So as we see these values of a sub n decrease, they're never going to become negative. And so we're going to kind of create a lower bound of sort of another sequence. Now I'm going to kind of, this is a sub n, and I'm looking at this a sub n, and that's going to be the lower limit. I don't know. We're going to kind of let this be c sub n just to get this notation exactly match the squeeze theorem notation, since we're just looking at it for the first time. And we're going to let a sub n equal 0, kind of like y equals 0. We have these values coming from our nth term of our sequence, which we're going to just change the labels to match our theorem of c sub n, and they're starting off at 2 and it stayed the same, and then they started to kind of shrink and they seem to be approaching 0. If I can find another function, if you will, or another nth term from a different sequence that is always above this c sub n, if I can find a b sub n that at some point at n, like it might be, you know, it might be, I don't know, smaller at some point, but if it goes past some fixed value of n, if at that point I can show that b sub n is always going to be larger than c sub n, but yet still approach 0 as, because I think this is going to have a limit as n approaches infinity of 0, then I can squeeze this given nth term in between them and go, well, this is limit is 0. This function or this nth term is always going to be bigger than this b sub n term is always going to be bigger than c sub n past some point, and it's approaching 0. And if so, if c sub n is always in between these two functions, then it itself has to approach 0 as n goes to infinity. Well, awesome. That means, though, that I have to come up with a function that I can validate or verify, show, that it's always going to be greater than this expression, and I need to be able to analytically evaluate its limit. Okay, so we already have, like they said, we already have a sub n. We're going to set that equal to 0. We need a, we're going to be looking at our c sub n values, and we need a b sub n, which is, we can analyze it, we can find its limit, but we can show that it's always bigger. How are we going to come up with a function that is always bigger? Well, it's a rational function. And if we can create a function where at some point we show that the denominator is always smaller, well, when you divide by a bigger number, you get a smaller answer. So if you divide by a smaller number, you get a bigger answer. And I need to come up with a denominator that ultimately is going to stay smaller than n factorial, but yet create a new function that will approach 0 as n goes to infinity, and I need to be able to easily analyze its limit. So I kind of want a denominator that's similar to the numerator. I need it to grow faster than the numerator, so the denominator is growing faster, thus it's approaching 0, and I need it to have, a similar behavior. So how about we let's analyze the difference between n factorial, the denominator of the given nth term, and how about 3 to the n power? Because if I have a b sub n, which is 2 to the n over 3 to the n, well then that's basically just 2/3 to the n power. Well, that's a geometric sequence. And when you have a geometric sequence where r is less than 1, then it's going to approach, it's going to approach 0 as n goes to infinity, because that's a decreasing function. Okay, so we're going to say, let's let n equal 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and so on, and look at the comparison of this original denominator with what I'm going to try and come up with as a new denominator, and see if there's some point where this 3n kind of, we can show that it's going to stay smaller than our n factorial. So extending out these denominators, we have n factorial 1 times 2. Well, down here we have 3 times 3 is 9. We have 1 times 2 times 3 is 6. We have 3 times 3 times 3 is 9. So in the beginning, the denominator of 3n is going to be larger than this denominator. Thus, 2 to the n over 3 to the n is going to be a smaller value than 2 to the n over n factorial. But as we extend this out at some point when n equals 7, the product here for n factorial is 5040, and 3 to the 7th power is 2187. I couldn't do that in my head, so I stepped off. So when n is greater than or equal to 7, we have the fact that, now look what happens beyond there. Not only is 3n to the n power smaller than n factorial, but from then on, we're going to just keep multiplying by 3 in the denominator to allow that denominator to grow, and we're going to start multiplying by 8 and 9 and 10, and values that just keep going up. So this denominator of n factorial is going to continue to grow faster than the denominator of 3 to the n. So for n greater than or equal to 7, we have 3n is less than n factorial. And thus, we have, let's see here, we have our original function of 0 is going to be less than, again, this is just for n greater than or equal to 7, is going to be less than 2 to the n over n factorial, which for n values greater than or equal to 7, greater than or equal to 7 is less than 2 to the n over 3 to the n. And we already showed sort of down here, but just put this in formal notation. We have the limit as n approaches infinity for 0. We have the limit as n approaches infinity of 2 to the n over 3 to the n, which can be rewritten as 2/3 to the n power. This is going to be 0. This is going to approach 0. And since this function of 2 to the n over n factorial is guaranteed to be greater than 0 and less than 2 to the n over 3 to the n for any n value greater than or equal to 7, then its limit must also be equal to 0. So by the squeeze theorem, we know that this approaches 0. Now let's get on to the next scene, which is going to be dealing with the definition of monotonic sequences. Bang!